we have about $1 billion of people's money that's invested through Perla. It's about $1 billion worth of Australians' money we look after. And it is quite a responsibility. It's something that we, you know, always focus on getting right.
Worrying about money keeps a lot of us awake at night. But when you're in the business of money, it's other people's cash that causes stress. When you're a new startup like investment app Perla, trust is everything. But the classic startup thinking of move fast and break things doesn't exactly assure future customers that their money is in good hands. So how do fintechs adapt? I'm Dr. Juliet Bourke, and this is The Business Of, a podcast from the University of New South Wales Business School. Hayden Smith is the co-founder of Perla, and he knows that when you're dealing with other people's cash, you have to do things differently. It helps to remember why he got into the business of money in the first place.
Perla, at a really high level, why we wake up every day, is a company that sees that there's too much financial stress in the world. Financial stress, it impacts everyone, relationships, families, and we're there to try and provide the education and tools to basically break down that stress. So we want people to live more relaxed, financially well lives. How we're trying to tackle that at the start is building a basic investing app that essentially allows people to invest in very safe, boring assets with the hope that one day they'll have enough passive income from those assets that they can, you know, take stress off their life because, you know, they don't have to work forever, basically.
All right. So it's the business of money, and it's, and you're trying to create a little pearl of wealth for yourself. That's
in essence.
So just talk me through then unscrewing finance, unscrewing personal finance. That's sort of part of the mantra as well, right? What does that actually mean?
Most people track their spending, reduce their spending, start investing, figure out what's a good savings account. There's this awareness that that stuff should happen, but most people are busy, tired, stressed. You know, the person who lives underneath me in my unit, she's a single mum with a 4-year-old and a 6-year-old. No doubt she both A, knows she should be doing this stuff, and B, doesn't have the time or headspace for it. And I think the headspace is a big thing because, you know, if you could just press a button and suddenly put all of your money in the best savings account and the right amount, everyone would probably do it. But they don't feel there's a place that they can get trustworthy information. It's not clear. So unscrewing it for us is just, again, like we always talk about education and tools. So the education part, we're not really, you know, an education provider, but it's more like we want to help guide people and make decisions easy. And then the tools are that we actually have to do the thing. Because there are apps out there that might help you understand how to invest, but they don't actually let you do it. So unscrewing for us is actually just providing the tools to make that happen as well.
So are you saying in this market of finance, which is a pretty busy market, there's nothing else like Perla?
At the moment, yeah. I mean, that's kind of why we started. The interesting thing about Perla is that mechanically, what we're doing is not that different. So there's a lot of products out there, self-wealth, stake, superhero, spaceship, I could list a lot. And many of them do the exact same thing. So for a well-educated, thoughtful person, they could go in and just buy the same ETF the same way. You know, in Australia, when you buy a stock or a share or an index fund, you have to buy a whole unit, right? When we started, we just said to our customers, you know, how much do you want to buy? They just type in 300 and we tell them that's how much you can buy and that's how much is left over. So in a way, if people kind of get lost on our unique value prop, it's often best summarized as just user experience. And that's mostly our platform. It's just an aggregate of those micro experiences.
The place in the market seems to be that you're not on the side of the banks or the investment funds, which are like, we deal with it this way. You move towards us, and whereas you're moving towards the consumer, which is just, I've got this amount of money and this is what I want to spend.
Yeah, and a very normal consumer, because a lot of the investing apps, quote unquote, out there, they're like us. We make money off commission. So every time someone buys or sells, we make money. And we're a very interesting platform because we're basically a platform that says you should buy investments and don't sell them. Whereas other apps out there, they make a lot of money by saying, you know, oh, you should buy, it's time to buy. What's going on in the market? You know, is CommBank up or down? They're incentivized to kind of to play into that trading culture, where activity is everything. And that's what scares normal people about investing, right? They think about, you know, the 1980s Wall Street movie. They think about all of those things, you know, men in suits running around, looking at charts, thinking about numbers, hearing about, everyone's heard about lithium. Should I buy lithium? You know, something's happening with electric cars. It's just, it's too much. So they target consumers, but they target that kind of subset of Australians that, you know, have the money and confidence to kind of engage with that. And they make good money off it, but that's not why we set out.
So let me just take you back to this boring investments. Because when I hear boring investments, I hear blue chip, you know, things that take a long time to mature, not rapid fire, yeah, no ups and downs, no volatility. Is that what you mean by boring?
Most of our customers, 75% of the things they invest in are ETFs or exchange traded funds. They're essentially, you buy buckets of shares. So these ETFs are really popular because when you're investing in a lot of stuff, naturally, there's some winners and losers, but you're brought down by the average. So Qantas does really poorly during COVID. Well, you know, CommBank picks up because they've got all this other money. It's just very slow moving up, very slow moving down, very predictable kind of long-term growth. We call it boring because nothing crazy happens. You put money in, like housing is boring. You know, the long-term prospect for housing is pretty clear. You can have some bumpy periods, but if you buy it and keep it for 20 years, you have a very boring story to tell generally. So it's we're trying to emulate that security people feel in housing with listed equities because it exists.
So that's just, you know, the business of money itself. Talk about that a bit. And I'm thinking here about, is it a challenge to go into the business, a startup business that's involving money? You know, why would you go there? Why wouldn't you go to another startup area?
It's definitely a challenge. I wouldn't want to sound too cliched, but it felt like the right place to go because money's so important. Sometimes I dream about a world where I go and build another like Duolingo or something, you know, those language apps. But then
I do know that language app. I'm obsessed.
That's good.
I'm like 365 days.
Yeah,
plus,
I see everyone obsessed with that, and I'm always like, if only I.
What
did
is that?
That? Yeah, exactly. Money's so important, you know. Like my family grew up in a financially stressed environment. A lot of people that I've cared about in life have the same kind of thing. I've seen relationships break down because of, you know, medical bills or, you know, just poor education or something. So it seemed like the right place to put my time. But one of the biggest challenges of it is any startup in a regulated space is generally really hard to get off the ground. This is true in health as well. So sometimes you refer to it as like health tech or fintech because things cost money to start. So like in our case, we wanted to build an app that was basically you deposit money and then you invest it. That means we need at least a few providers. We need to work with a bank. We need to work with an identity check provider, someone who verifies your passport and driver's license. We needed to work with a broker who actually does the investments on the stock market. If you sign up to Perla and you don't even invest, you cost us money. We have to pay other people to like verify you. So it's a tricky company to start because you need some money. And I was very lucky that my co-founder, Nick, he's like 10 years older than me. So he's like, at the time he was mid-30s and he'd just been working for a long time. And, you know, he had like a couple $100,000 sitting around that he could throw at it. And it's like, we would have been, there's no way we could start without that. I know people get all like, just have an idea and work hard. But like, no, we needed a couple $100,000 to get started. So yeah, working in a regulated space, I think, is particularly tricky because you have to identity check people because the bank won't let you in otherwise, you know. So yeah, a few hurdles like that.
So there's hurdles, but is there also a fair bit of pressure in dealing with other people's cash?
Yeah, definitely. Definitely. I think what's scary is I think right now we have about $1 billion worth of Australians' money we look after. And it is quite a responsibility. It's something that we always focus on getting right. Thankfully, technology these days is fairly robust and, you know, we spend a lot of time trying to keep it safe and everything like that. Australia's a great place to invest because there's, you know, good protections. Like, you know, we're an insured company, we're a regulated company, we have people oversee us. So, you know, even in some horrible case where something goes wrong with Pearl, or our customers are still protected. I think if we were in like a bit of a dodgy country where we could have done anything. And if the money's gone, the money's gone. Like those crypto horror stories you hear about, I'd definitely be stressed a lot more. But yeah, it's definitely a responsibility.
Oh, you're very grounded. You're in the business of money, which is a long-term play for you in particular.
Yep.
It's a long-term play. But there is this ethos in startup land which is fail fast,
yep.
break things. How yep. do you navigate that tension?
Yeah. I mean, the first startup book I read was The Lean Startup, like a fairly popular book around, you know, and the message of the book is essentially learn things quickly, even at the expense of creating friction. We do a lot of that. We often generally, we try things out. We release betas all the time, like half finished products to our customers constantly. And we just tell them, we're like, this is half finished. Tell us what you think, you know, and then we'll abandon some and we'll keep working on some. But the interesting thing about finance is you have to be really careful where you do that.
Right. Someone's going to lose money on that beta, right?
Yeah.
And it's not you.
I think, yeah, it's interesting. Yeah, exactly. Back to signals. You don't know where the confidence signals will disappear, you know? So for instance, if someone's trying to, you know, buy something and you give them a different way to buy it and it doesn't work, they don't think that it not working is going to impact them financially, but it not working, if you don't explain it right, makes them think, is this thing broken? Is this thing like poorly managed? Is it a bad team? Is my money's in there? Am I going to lose all my money? So back to the trust thing, it's you have to be really careful with how you do this stuff. You have to do a lot of like, you know, coming soon as opposed to just trying something out. Trust is a massive thing you can accidentally lose if you employ these kinds of like classic hyperscale startup ideas too often. We still do them a lot, but we have to be restrained about it.
You talked previously about there being this sort of word of mouth referrals. And so that in itself is a trust mechanism, friends introducing friends. How do you as a brand build trust? How do you throw those signals of trust?
Yeah, trust is a big thing for us. Probably the two biggest things. One is that we identified really early on that it takes a long time for people to trust institutions. I tell people often that, you know, even as someone who, when there's a new finance company out there, I probably am in the top 1% of people who can identify how risky it is, because it's my day job is to think about this. So you know what to look for. And even then, I still wouldn't touch it for months. Like even if there was an amazing, people link me all the time. They're like, oh, here's a new peer-to-peer loan thing. Here's a new bank. Here's a new investing app. And I'm like, cool, cool. And I kind of put it in my back pocket. I'm like, I don't even think of that consciously. It's just like a habit. It's like when you see a new ice cream at Woolworths, sometimes you're like, oh, I don't know what that is. I'll come, whatever, another time. So we identified that early that we just needed to get in market. So even though early on we didn't have a lot of customers, we kind of knew that we just had to get the brand out there, generate wait lists, talk about what we're doing, see if we could generate some media spin. And I say this, you know, to my co-founder a lot. It's like sometimes we'll go to launch a new product or a new aspect of something. I think we mused a while ago about, oh, wouldn't it be cool to start a super fund in a few years or something, you know? And I say it's like, if we were to launch a super fund, you have to go in knowing that you're going to have 2 years where not a lot of people touch it. I wouldn't, no matter how much I like a company, I'm not going to go move my super across like straight away. Some people do, and they're amazing because we'd be a dead company without them, right? But it's like for most normal people, they kind of look at it and they think, I'm not too sure. So time in market's a massive thing for us. And then the second thing is we do everything we can just to be very transparent with our customers, which I think helps a lot. Like, we don't have a massive legal team or we have no PR team. We barely have a marketing team. So if we make a mistake, we just email our customers and tell us what happened. If we're doing something new, we let them know. In a lot of ways, I guess, we try our best to respect our customers' intelligence and agency. Naturally, I'm sure that will bite us sometimes. You know, sometimes we do say something and customers will use it as leverage to, you know, really complain or something like that. But in the long run, we think it pays off as always trying to be honest and upfront with them, because we like to think our consumers are quite smart and can, you know, take the information.
It sounds like it's a very sort of low key. Is that part of the trust thing? It's a very direct relationship between you and that, you know, there is no PR department. There is no person that's interfacing. It's
yeah, definitely. I wish there was
Hayden
a PR department
Nick.
Sometimes. I could go to bed earlier, you know, like, because there's always something going on. But I remember in the early days, we'd make a mistake and deposits that were meant to come in on a Tuesday came in on a Wednesday. And we'd be like, oh, you know, we got to email 600 people tonight and explain this to them. And there's always, you know, it's like there might be a customer that says like, I was going to invest in Combank tomorrow and it was $60 a share. And now it's gone up to like $62 a share. You guys owe me $300, you know, and it's not that that's an unreasonable complaint. I'm not dissing on that person, but that's the risk we carried, as opposed to, you know, we could make up some story or, you know, put on some protections. But yeah, no, it's very low key. I mean, that's just, I mean, we treat people, again, like we would our friends or something. I mean.
Or the woman who lives.
Yeah, exactly. Like these are real people. Mm. They're not kind of, you know, little sheep that we're trying to move around.
Yeah, they sound very real to you.
Yeah, and there is a cost to that sometimes, but we think it's worth it for sure.
So one of the things, obviously, with trust is data security. How do you navigate that?
It's top of mind for people. Firstly, we're really lucky that we're a startup, right? Because, and I've seen this, I have a lot of friends that like Atlassian and Google, and all it takes is one very silly person to do something silly. So at a small company, it's great because everyone's kind of aware of everything that's going on. So in some ways, startups can feel a little more confident than a larger company. But the other, you know, helpful part for us is that we use a lot of external services. All startups basically run on like either Google or Amazon servers, which means that, you know, Google and Amazon, they get really good at managing security. So this kind of like outsourcing method, there's a lot less that we have to manage as technologists that you'd expect, but where we mainly focus our time is on processes and practices internally, because at the end of the day, you know, our biggest risk, like any company, is always going to be our employees. Not that they would do anything malicious, but a good example is that only myself and my lead engineer have access to we call it production data, but that's basically our actual customers' data. So all of our engineers work with a copy of all that data that's randomized. So they can like log into an account, but it doesn't have your name or your bank account. It just has like random numbers there and random names there. And we do that so that they don't accidentally do something silly. If their laptop's stolen or they leave it open at a Christmas party, nothing bad can happen. You try and avoid giving access to people for something until they need it. I talk regularly to the team about the fact that you need to view access as a burden, not a bonus, basically. Like everyone likes the idea of having power, like the key, right? The master key. Like if you work at, you know, at a big office and you can unlock any door, it feels great. But actually getting into the mentality of you don't want that, because then if someone breaks in, they're going to look at you and say, like, you had the key, so is this you? So there's a lot of things we do internally that we punch above our weight for. We recently got certified for ISO 27001, which is basically an information security standard. I don't know many companies that are consumer-facing with, you know, 16 employees that have done that, so we definitely invest a lot of time into it.
This is not your first rodeo in terms of a startup.
Yes, correct.
Going into this one, how is that sort of different in terms of your knowledge base or your approach to this startup?
It's a great question. I think that the two things that I learned from the previous startup were that the people you start the company with are really important. And the people I started the last company with, I started it with two, they were great individuals. But I don't think we had the skill sets that complemented each other or the backgrounds. You know, so for example, Nick, my co-founder now, he came from like private equity and before that family offices. And, you know, for those that don't know what that means, he was basically in charge of managing people way richer than him, right? And so in the business, he was so good at everything with like how to organize the company. He works with the accountants, the lawyers. He knows how to negotiate contracts. So I'm like an engineer. So, you know, he just kind of put some employment contracts in front of me, or he'll help me figure out how we're going to organize like pay bumps or, you know, and that's been so helpful having someone with complementary skills. I think in the last startup, we were all a bit too close in terms of our own skill sets and backgrounds, and none of us had kind of cash lying around to help fund the company too. So probably the biggest thing that I noticed with Perla was we had cash to get going. And we had like the right kind of mix of people at the top to kind of cover all the bases for sure.
Do you think you need a different kind of mindset to be successful in a fintech as opposed to another kind of tech?
You definitely have to tame your wild side a little more, I'd say. Fintech definitely feels like the slightly more, you know, patient, responsible startup. Like we've been around 5 years, right? But we've only been in market for three. And that's because the first 2 years we were trying to exchange emails with banks and brokers trying to get started. Because like you go to Macquarie Bank, you're like, hey, we're a business. We're a PTY LTD. Like, why would they care? They're going to, like, usually if you talk to a bank and you say we want to use a bank account for business, like us, first question, what's your projections? how many customers will you have in 2 years? Like, convince us this is worth our time. So the time it took to get it off the ground and the cost meant like you had to be a bit more responsible. And again, the customers are more unrelenting with, you know, not being trustworthy. So a lot of it's just about being more careful. We're way more like lean and startup-y than like a bank, right? By like 100 times. But compared to maybe a typical like San Francisco startup, we're definitely like a lot more patient and careful.
So what would you say to founders who are wanting to start up a business in the business of money?
Usual advice I would give is be patient. Back to the previous point, don't quit your day job. There's like a usual mantra in the startup world that is, you know, you got to go all in. If you don't go all in, then it's not going to come alive, you know? I usually say you need to go all in on a startup once you feel like you are the prohibiting factor of its growth. Because when you start a company, you know, it doesn't matter if it's like Perla or if it's a company selling beads in necklaces. It's like in the early days, it's not going to be the fact for many companies that like you're the problem, right? Eventually, like with Perla, like for instance, myself, I worked full time at my university I studied at to pay the rent for nearly two. I don't think I got a salary till 3 years into the company. So I was working for free for 3 years. If I went all in, like 40, 50 hours a week, I would have just run out of money and burnt out. And it was like doing that full-time job at the uni, earning that money, which helped me also pay for some things in Perla, whilst we couldn't move faster. That was so important. And I see people burn out all the time. You'd be amazed how many people start companies and then just burn out, you know?
Oh, no.
I know you know that as well. Yeah. Yeah, it's crazy. So patience.
So the mindset of move fast and break things doesn't really work when you're in charge of other people's money. But does it actually work anywhere? Professor Frederick Ansell isn't so sure. Frederick is the Senior Deputy Dean at the University of New South Wales Business School. And he says that the further founders move away from the old mentality of failing fast and failing often, the better.
I think in general, people are sort of realizing that move fast, break things, that you break a lot of things, and that is not necessarily a good thing. And so I think what you now have this realization is that if you want to learn from failure, you need to not necessarily fail fast, but fail clever. In the financial industry, failing is potentially much more risky, right? Because the consequences can be huge. And of course, in financial institutions, financial industry, trust is everything. And it's very difficult gaining trust. It goes very slowly, but you can lose it very easily. And so that's why I think people are probably a bit more careful when it comes to losing trust and failing in the financial industry. So you need to fail in a clever way. And so what you typically would do is, for instance, you test out things that can fail, but it means that you would learn as much from the success as you would learn from the failure. And so a typical example would be A/B testing, right? Is that you have a discussion maybe with your management team and there's not a lot of agreement on what would be the exact positioning or what sort of incentive scheme would you set up or what sort of program would you set up. Some people would be discussing and the old ways of doing would that maybe the CEO or the entrepreneur would in the end say, that's my decision, that's what we'll do. The clever way to do it is basically, well, if we don't agree, let's test both programs. Let's test both incentive schemes on a small scale. Let's be very strict, set up that sort of A/B experiment in two different markets, small group markets. Let's run it for a couple of weeks and let's see what works best. And so one of them will have failed, but from the failure, you learn that the other one works or not. In my own research, I do a lot of research on reflection. And so what you can do is also have structured reflection in teams. And so, for instance, you could do it in a financial institution. Imagine that you have a whole program, you've been running it for 3 months. And then at some point you say, let's stop here and let's assess and evaluate. And instead of just looking at what you've achieved, the target numbers, you roll it back almost like you're looking back at a movie. Sometimes they will record entire things and they will look at the movie and they will stop it almost like you're analyzing a football game. And they will say, so what was happening here exactly? What contributed here to success? What were all the little building blocks, the causal model of all the little things that made it into a failure or into a success? And so if you do it in a hospital, right, sometimes if you have this very serious surgeries, and I've worked with a hospital there, a surgery can take up to 10 hours, right? And so many things happen, and there's always little incidents that are happening. They will record it. And then later in the week with the whole team, and often that is a team of 10, 15 people around it, they will take part in that after event review, go through the whole recording of it, and will try to find the moments where there was a risk, where something happened that was a success factor or was a potential failure factor, and they will try to set a causal model of failure and success. And that is how you actually learn from those things.
Perhaps the days of failing fast are numbered. Maybe it's time to fail thoughtfully instead. If you're in the business of money, the risks are high, but the opportunities are worth it. As technology continues to improve at a rapid pace, more tools like Perla can help regular people take control of their money. But that doesn't mean you should quit your job today, move to Silicon Valley and hustle your way to success. Success slowly might not be as catchy as fail fast, but in the business of money, it's the only way.
The Business Of podcast is brought to you by the University of New South Wales Business School, produced with Deadset Studios. To stay up to date with our latest podcasts, as well as the latest insights and thought leadership from the Business School, subscribe to BusinessThink at businessthink.unsw.edu.au.